The Herd. Wherever you may be and however you may be listening, we're on iHeartRadio, Fox Sports Radio. Not on TV today, not FS1, we're on FS2. We're on XM Sirius Channel 83. Joy Taylor is joining me. On a Monday, Matt Barnes, Howard Beck, Bleacher Report senior NBA writer, will join us today. Oliver Luck, the XFL is now official. It's a football league. I'll get into that this hour. That's a league where I could not say a bunch for the last 2 months. XFL is represented by my representation agency, CAA, by the company that employs me, Fox, by the company that used to employ me, ESPN. They all made this come together. A lot of information I had to kind of withhold for the last 2 months. I'm going to talk about the XFL. It's a new league with a billionaire founder on the two biggest sports networks in America, with legalized sports gambling, and Oliver Lux, the CEO, commissioner, one of the smartest guys in sports running it. It's going to work. It's going to work big. It is spring football. The schedule's out. It feels and looks legitimate. And I'll talk about that later. But it's a Monday, Joy. And you know what that means.
That means we get to talk about how right and wrong you've been.
And I was a lot of both all this week. So let's do it, right, wrong.
Where Colin was right.
Okay. We can keep running to Twitter and saying how great Embiid is, but Embiid and Simmons don't work together. Outside of Golden State, Philadelphia has got the second most talent in the league. Embiid and Simmons are oil and water. Simmons can't play with a dominant big because it clogs the lane, and he's not a perimeter player. And Embiid is absolutely at his best on the low block. But with Simmons sometimes needing to score low, Embiid moves out, and that's not really his strength. They're never going to work together. Now, they do have moments. The Sixers will have these 4 and 6 minute spurts where they look like the world's best team. They're like the Warriors with some Globetrotters. I mean, they're so much fun to watch. But they are struggling. They lost home court again yesterday. Embiid, for the second time in this series, was invisible. Simmons has been, throughout the series, at times invisible. They don't work together. Win or lose this series, Simmons and Embiid, oil and water.
Where Colin was wrong.
The shock of the playoffs isn't Kawhi. He's always been good. The shock of the playoffs is the Denver Nuggets. Jokic has been a monster. They have one guy in their entire roster with playoff experience, Paul Millsap. They have the youngest playoff team I can ever remember, and now they have home court advantage. 3 games left, 2 in Denver against Portland, and they have shown unbelievable resilience in this series. Listen, we all knew the East is weaker than the West, and Toronto would win a playoff series. We knew that's not a shock. We knew Milwaukee was going to win a playoff series or two. Denver blows me away. You're not supposed to win in this league in the playoffs with one star and a bunch of kids. It doesn't work that way. They've been, to me, the shock of the playoffs.
Where Colin was right.
Monty Williams took the Phoenix Suns job over the Lakers job last week. If you're the Lakers and that doesn't terrify you, I don't know what does. Suns have had 6 coaches in 6 years. It's a poorly owned franchise. Folks, the Lakers are exactly what we've been telling you for 6 months. It is a circus. LeBron James has a TV show with Maverick Carter called The Shop. And here's an illustration of how little communication happens at the top of the franchise.
My right hand comes to me and say, Magic just stepped down. And I'm like, man, get the out of my face. You I go check my phone. I look at it. It happened. Personally, for me, I came here to be a part of the Lakers organization, having a conversation with Magic. So it was just weird for him to just be like, I'm out of here. And hey, Bron, kiss my ass, I'm gone. It wasn't even that.
LeBron's not happy. He's the biggest star in the city on a sports team. And they didn't text him? CEO, the owner, the GM, the president. They didn't get a text? It is a rudderless ship.
Where Colin was wrong.
Jayson Tatum's one of my favorite young NBA players. Smart, long, athletic, can shoot, can drive, put it on the deck. He's averaging less than 10 points a game in this series and shooting 35% against Milwaukee. Now, some of it is Milwaukee plays real defense. You don't get any cheap points down low with Giannis standing there. But he has got to be more aggressive. I really like his game. I think he's a tremendous young player. And I would acknowledge that Kyrie is not always the easiest guy in the world to play with. But Jayson Tatum has completely disappeared in this series. He is out of rhythm. He doesn't look confident. And it's remarkable because last year, without Kyrie on the court, when it was kind of his and Al Horford's team in the playoffs, he rose as a rookie. He played his best basketball of the year in the playoffs. Now in his second year, he has disappeared in this series.
Where Colin was right.
I said, I don't believe in conspiracy theories, but watch the Rockets and Warriors. That no call on the James Harden charge, that's the Saints-Rams pass interference call. You got to be kidding me. 41 seconds left when that thing starts. 49. You're not calling that a charge? I'm watching that on television right now. Come on now. Did that not feel like the NBA with three referees staring at it wanted a game five? I mean, that's Rams Saints right there. And you know how much heat the Rams Saints got. And I know the NFL is way more popular than the NBA, but that's what I said about this game. I thought it would come early. It came late. There would be a call where we'd be going, oh, I get it. That's as bad a call in a big spot as I can remember in the NBA. That's what I worried about. I've defended the NBA for years. I'm not into conspiracy theories. They butchered that moment.
Where Colin was right.
We've been saying since the NFL season ended, two or three teams in the NFL are going to be pullback teams. Bears, Saints, Ravens. And last week, Vegas came out with their over-unders and agreed on all of them. Saints won 13 games last year. I predicted 9. Vegas is at 10. Chicago, 12. I predict 9. Vegas at 9. Baltimore at 10 last year. I predict 7. Vegas has them higher, 8.5. But in all three, especially the Bears, Vegas clearly sees what I saw late last year with Chicago, which is in the last month of starts for Mitch Trubisky, and Green Bay's defense is better. I think Detroit's better. I think Minnesota has a little bounce back year. Vegas agrees on all three teams, all 3 minute playoffs. Saints, Bears, Ravens, they're pulling back.
Where Colin was wrong.
Chris Middleton, I said last week, he shouldn't be a two. You can't get to the finals with Chris Middleton as a two. He's not a good enough ball handler. He can shoot. Well, he's been great. 24 points. He's shooting 63% from three against the Celtics, 5.5 rebounds, 86% at the line. He's been great. Now, I still think Middleton on a championship team is a three, on some teams maybe a four, but since I said he was not a number two star, he's been fans. Not a number two star, he's been fantastic. And because you have to double and spend so much time on Giannis, it leaves Middleton open. And I thought going into this series, you know, Tatum would end up elevating like last year in the playoffs. He's vanished. And Middleton, who I thought would kind of shrink in the playoffs, has actually played his best basketball of the year.
Where Colin was right.
Everybody tells me instant replay is great. And my belief is too much instant replay adds confusion, delays, and doesn't make sports better. It's sports version of micromanaging. So the favorite horse at the Kentucky Derby, wire-to-wire led, they went to replay. We sat around for 15 minutes. It was an embarrassing, messy ending, and maximum security because it drifted out of its lane on a turn. You know, it is a horse. They kind of have their own way of doing things. And replay took away the wire-to-wire winner. I got nothing against horses. They're beautiful. But, you know, they have a piece of metal in their mouth and they get whipped. They're not humans. They may drift a little in a race, especially when the track's a mess. And we go to replay in 144 Kentucky Derbies. That's the replay center. That looks like me at home on a Sunday watching NFL. And that you upturned a Kentucky Derby. But Colin, if it was a horse race in Illinois, it's not. It's the Kentucky Derby. It's why you don't throw pass interference flags in the Super Bowl in a Hail Mary. It's the Kentucky Derby. Sports has always had situational officiating and muddy track. It's a horse, drifted a little. This is where I don't like replay. If officials in NFL football can make a mistake, a horse can't drift a little? A little? I don't know. Maybe you horse people probably hate me on this. You're experts, I'm not. But that was a disastrous ending to the greatest, what they call the greatest 2 minutes in sports, greatest 3 minutes in sports. That was a mess. I didn't like it at all.
Where Colin was right.
Best high school quarterback in the country, plays in California, didn't even acknowledge USC and UCLA or the Pac-12. He's going to play at Clemson. I said a couple of years ago, I love college football. There was a time it was my favorite sport. But when Clemson and Alabama can now come out west and take the top Western players, it tells you the sport's become lopsided and overly regional. I'm sorry, but you shouldn't have USC going to Florida and getting their best players, and going to Ohio and getting their best players, and going to Georgia and getting all their best players. College football has become too regional. This is nothing against Clemson. They're awesome. It's nothing against Alabama. But you have something going on right now. College basketball, as good as Duke is, there's no guarantees. I can guarantee you the championship game next year, Alabama has 9 first-rounders projected in the draft, and Clemson, I think, is better. Best high school quarterback didn't acknowledge the West Coast. He's going to Clemson, which until Dabo Swinney wasn't even considered a national university. It was kind of a regional, you know, ACC university. Calling right, calling wrong. Good to have you in. What was your takeaway on the Kentucky Derby, Joy?
I'm so with you. I'm so with you. I was confused.
I was completely
we were eating lunch and I watched it. I'm like, oh, okay, the horse won. Just go back to my chicken wings and look up. I'm like, well, that's not the horse that won. And what happened? I don't.
It drifted.
I feel bad for the gamblers in that spot too.
It's a horse. It's.
I don't understand it. I really don't. I didn't even know that was a thing. Did you know that was a thing?
Well, I know you. It could be interference in horse racing. They put it back in 17th. Now, the horse racing purist will say, this is absolutely the way it should work. And my takeaway is, and I've been arguing this for years, sports is situational. I went to a boxing match Saturday night, Canelo and Jacobs. In a boxing match, if you go to the 12th round and the champion and the challenger are deadlocked, it's close, and a guy's in trouble, right? Like, let's say the champion's in trouble. You're going to let the challenger throw an extra punch or two because he has a chance to knock out the middleweight champion of the world, if that was the case. The reality of sports is you don't call pass interference on a Hail Mary because it's a Hail Mary. This idea that sports is always letter to the law, that's what replay wants. Humans play it, humans coach it, humans officiate it.
Right, but this is a horse.
And horses on a wet track drift? I don't know. It felt like to me it was an instance. You let it go. I know everybody says, hey, if that was another horse race, it's not. It's the Kentucky
right,
Derby.
It's the Super Bowl of horse racing.
Right.
So you don't do that in that spot.
Yes.
I'm also with you on the replay center.
Did you think that was odd looking?
Yes, that looks
like me.
It looks like an edit room. Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, listen, all the horse racing aficionados will come out of the woodwork on this. You're wrong. It just felt like, yeah, you just butchered the Kentucky Derby. Wow. Howard Beck's around the corner. Bleacher Report senior NBA writer. My thoughts on Steph Curry. I'll have some of those. Woj on Durant. The XFL is now a real thing. We'll talk about that. Joy's got Herdline news after this, too. A couple of weeks now, I've been reminding you about Mother's Day. And it's just days away. It's May 12th, so it's next weekend. To help you pick out a bouquet. Now, today only, when you order a dozen sorbet roses, they'll give you an extra half dozen free, plus a vase. Okay, so you're getting a dozen, then you're getting 6, and a vase for $29.99. Limited time offer, only available today. It's a mix of pastel shades, orange, pink, lavender, great roses, picked at their peak, shipped overnight, ensure freshness. So buy a dozen, get a half dozen in a vase free. $29.99, amazing offer. Go to 1-800-Flowers.com, $29.99. 1-800-Flowers.com. Put in the code HERD, H-E-R-D. Now, this offer for 1-800-Flowers for Mother's Day, it ends today. It's a one-time deal. It's today, Monday only. 1-800-Flowers.com, code HERD.